Aren't we all delighted that St. Patrick's Day rolls around? Because it's a rite of spring and it means the winter is over. Boy, did we get that wrong. But that line is a little bit thin tonight. I particularly, in welcoming you, and I'll be welcoming many people, I particularly want to make sure to welcome Barbara Jones, the Consul General of Ireland here in New York. Barbara Jones is here. Whatever about the weather, it does seem that we have arrived at a crossroads of sort in the economic and political affairs in the United States and in Western Europe, and perhaps even in the wider world, where the byword clearly is change. Conventional wisdom is no longer accepted. The status quo is under challenge, and the way forward contains many more question marks and fuzzy indicators than many of us might like. Last year, when Dennis Swanson and I, along with the board members of the Ireland US Council, met in New York to consider planning for this event, we knew change was in the air. The Brexit result to pull the United Kingdom out of the European Union had surprised many. There had also been an election in Ireland with some changes to the government in Dublin. Another election had been called in Northern Ireland by the government in Belfast. When the US election in November saw President Donald Trump elected, we knew that the time was right to convene this gathering. Our hope is that when we conclude tomorrow, we may all be a little wiser, better informed, and better equipped to understand the forces that are shaping the future roadmap, as those of us in this space of the most dynamic of economic relationships, as the one between Ireland and America surely is, try to shine a light on the way forward. Of course, events of this type could not be contemplated without the support of partners. This is why I have pieces of paper, because there's so many people we want to thank that I want to make sure that I don't leave anybody out. But first of all, our thanks to Anne Herity and Danny McCoy of IBEC for agreeing to partner with us, the Ireland US Council, on this business summit. A big thanks also to our sponsors, whose support has been invaluable. Thank you to Bernard Byrne, the CEO of the AIB Group. Thanks also to Brendan Cahill of William Fry, solicitors, from whom we will hear shortly. John Riley of Squire Batten Pogs. David Evans of Canyon CTS Group. Paddy Cunningham of United Airlines. And Niall Maloney of Shannon Group, Emmanuel Dowdall of IDA Ireland, and our media partners, Niall O'Dowd and Patricia Harty of Irish American Magazine. It's now my pleasure to ask one of our board members from the Ireland chapter of the Ireland US Council and a sponsor of this business summit, Brendan Cahill of the law firm of William Fry in Dublin, is going to say a few words. Thank you. Brendan.
Thank you, Brian. I'd like to welcome you all here today to a frosty St. Patrick's Eve. I left Austin this morning at 25 degrees, and it was a particular shock to the body to arrive here in New York at the staggering weather we're having at the moment. William Fry are particularly pleased to be part of this conference and to support this conference. As law firms, as lawyers in Ireland, were particularly connected to international business flows and were particularly interested in looking at the changing infrastructure that's emerging in the world. We're looking at fascinated horror with the slow train wreck that's Brexit. We see a need to recalibrate our relationship with the EU as a result of Brexit and as a result of actions like the Apple case. And the evolving tax arrangements in the US are going to provide challenges for us and opportunities for us as well. So when we were asked by the Council to sponsor this, it didn't take us very long to know that this was a very worthy and welcome event for us to participate on. We've always been very good as a country in maximising our physical and intellectual properties in our business trading and our partnership with key groups and key structures around the world. And I've no doubt that the challenges that are coming from the shifting tectonic plates will cause us some difficulties. But I'm also extremely confident that we will be able, over the coming years, to meet some wonderful challenges and opportunities that will arise. We will see difficulties with our food businesses exporting to the UK, but we will also see significant FDI flows, I think, from elsewhere, and also movement of financial services businesses from London and elsewhere as well. So I'm looking forward really tonight to listening to the fantastic slate of speakers that David and his team has brought together here. I think we will benefit from their erudition and knowledge, and I think we will know a lot more by lunchtime tomorrow when we sit down to our Patrick's Day lunch. This event wouldn't have been able to be such a great success without David O'Sullivan and his team, Anne Herity and the board of IBEC, Danny McCoy as well, Dennis Swanson and Brian, who's been a particular driving force behind this. So I'd like to thank all of them for their great work in making sure we've managed to get to this juncture tonight. I'd also like to welcome our next speaker. He's a native of Illinois, a former member of the Marine Corps. He's had a distinguished career in television, having been a past president of ABC and CBS. So it's my particular pleasure to welcome Dennis Swanson. Thank you.
I'm delighted, actually, though, to be here this evening. Before introducing our guest speaker, Mick Mulvaney, I wanted to say a few words about the Ireland-US Council. This council was founded the year before John F. Kennedy's visit to Ireland, the first ever state visit to Ireland by a sitting U.S. president. So here in these rooms in the Metropolitan Club 54 years ago, it has been our unofficial home ever since, some distinguished Irish-American business folks gathered to build institutional form around a structure to improve the economic, business, and commercial relations between America and Ireland. They were people like John D.J. Moore, who later served as U.S. Ambassador to Ireland, J. Peter Grace, Walter Curley, and many others who wanted to make sure that President Kennedy's visit to Ireland on those four magic days of June in 1963 would be leveraged in a positive and hopefully continuing way into the future. At that time, two organizations were created. One was dedicated to cultural relations, the American-Irish Foundation, now a part of the American-Ireland Fund. The other, the Ireland-US Council, which was and continues to be dedicated to the building business bonds and commercial connections between the two countries. One of the things I discovered when I was president of the Ireland-US Council during many visits to the Emerald Island is that the people of Ireland, not just the government, but the people of Ireland are deeply committed to the process of economic development through free enterprise and through free trade. One of the examples that I like to cite that this council, way back in 1982, presented its annual award for outstanding achievement to Dr. T.K. Whitaker. He was the man, and I'd have to add, he was a civil servant, not elected, a civil servant who shaped the policy to move Ireland away from the protectionism that was the prevailing economic model since the foundation of the state toward a completely free trade, open economy model. It was his idea back in the 1950s, endorsed, of course, by the government and parliament of the day, and I should add, by every government and Doyle since then, to shape the corporate tax system that favored growth through private sector enterprise and that encouraged foreign investment in Ireland. Dr. Whitaker lived to see his 100th birthday and died only very recently. But before he died, he was celebrated as the Irishman of the 20th century in a vote carried out amongst viewers by RTE, Ireland's national TV service. Now, there was some tough competition for that. It wasn't Michael Collins who got the award. It wasn't Eamon de Valera or William Butler Yeats or James Joyce or even Bono. But a civil servant who was famous for writing economic policy papers. My point here is that Ireland has a long-standing tradition of economic policies that favor economic growth and development through private enterprise. It is not a set of nouveau flavor of the month tax ideas. Ireland's corporate tax strategy has stood the test of time and has been around longer than most people in this room have been alive. However, that makes you feel better. I do not include myself in that group. The Irish economy today is the most open economy on earth. Ireland's economy lives and dies by competition and free trade. Irish companies in the United States employ almost as many American workers as workers in America as American-owned firms employ Irish workers in Ireland. We in the Ireland U.S. Council have been proud to play a small part in this dynamic and evolving but surely powerful economic relationship. We hope that the business bonds between the United States and the Emerald Isle will continue to flourish. And hopefully this business summit will be one small part of the larger process that will ensure closer commercial connections between the two countries in the future. And now, as our guest speaker this evening, we will hear from someone who is from the top tier of our government here in the United States. Mick Mulvaney was nominated as Director of the Office of Management and Budget by President Donald Trump in December 2016 and confirmed by the United States Senate, and that's no small feat in this day and age, just last month. He was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives in 2011. He was the first Republican since 1883 to represent South Carolina's 5th Congressional District, where he served until his confirmation as OMB Director, and he has served also in the South Carolina General Assembly from 2007 to 2011, first in the State House of Representatives and then in the U.S. and then in the State Senate. I have read that Mick Mulvaney visits Ireland quite often and is proud of his Irish heritage. He's pretty sure his relatives, relatives came from County Mayo, which is where my great-grandfather and his father, my great-great-grandfather, got on a hunger ship in 1853 and came to America. He plays golf at La Hinch, and he keeps Irish butter in his refrigerator, so you should have a lot of friends here in this room. And I'm very proud and pleased to be able to invite to the podium the director of the OMB in the United States and a man who's got a huge role to play in our government and who is giving up after some long nights, I'm sure, working on the budget to be with here through inclement weather, Mick Mulvaney.
Thank you for that. Before I start, I had to laugh when Brendan got up and said he left Austin, Texas, and it was 25 degrees. That's really cold, Brendan, where we're from. What is that, like 75 or something like that in Fahrenheit? And as to Dennis's comments about Andrew Jackson, I can assure you it was in South Carolina because it's like a mile from my house. So if you come visit, I can show you where he was actually born. I am not going to talk very long tonight. There's a couple reasons for that. Most of them, I think, are good. First of all, I used to be an elected official. I learned a very valuable lesson when I was in the state legislature, which is a part-time job. I was still in the real estate and the restaurant business and serving, and I had to go to speak at the opening of a cancer center in my home county in the middle of July. It was a new doctor's office that was opening, and there were 9 politicians that were invited, and I can assure you that I was the least of the 9, which means that I went last. And we were outside in Lancaster County, South Carolina, in the middle of July, and it was 104 degrees, and all of the goodies were inside where there was air conditioning. And all the other politicians got up and talked for at least 15 minutes each, and I got up at the very end. They introduced me. I got up and I said, thanks very much for coming out, and I left. And I sat down, and this little old lady walked up to me as we're walking into the air conditioning, and she said, young man, that is the best political speech I've ever seen in my entire life. Also, not going to talk very long because tomorrow we're unveiling the budget, which is, I'm told is a big day for the Office of Management Budget, and I have to do 4 or 5 of the morning shows here in New York starting at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning, which is on MSNBC, which doesn't like me very much, so I'm sure they won't, they'll be yelling at me a good bit. But the last reason that I'm not going to speak for very long, we landed here at 4:30, which was on time from Washington, D.C., and I walked in here about 10 minutes ago. It took us almost 2 hours, more than 2 hours, to get here from the airport. And I was thinking, well, that's okay. Originally, I was going to go to the hotel, change. If my grandfather knew I was wearing this tie, he'd roll over in his grave. But I was going to work on my speech, which they handed me as I walked out the door. Well, that's not unusual for me. They'll give me what they want me to say at an event that's completely pre-approved by the West Wing and completely appropriate for the audience and so forth, so that I don't say anything really stupid to make the news. And then we got in the cab, we're in the tunnel, and we realize it's going to be a two-hour ride to get in here. I'm like, well, I better work on the speech in the car. At least I should probably read what they have written for me. And that's when I realized I left the speech in the airplane. So I am making this up as I go along, and the other elected officials in town will know how dangerous that is. I was giving some thought before when I got invited to do this. First of all, I'm the fill-in, apparently. Y'all wanted the vice president and had to settle for me. I apologize for that. He's a much better speaker than I am. But actually, your ambassador called, and she said, look, Mick, we've invited the vice president. He can't do it because the Taoiseach, I think, is in Washington tonight, and they have some formal events to take care of. She goes, could you fill in for him? And I said, I would do anything for your ambassador, by the way. She's a lovely, lovely woman. I think her term is up in July of this year, and whoever... two people could not take her place. She has done a tremendous job on behalf of Ireland for the last couple of years, and I would literally do anything she asked me to do. Please. So we do look forward to the government naming the next person. Very curious to see who it is. She's been fantastic. But I was trying to think about what to talk about, because the way that I got to meet Anne is through immigration. And it was quite by accident. I think she wandered in when I was a freshman in Congress, and I wasn't on the relevant committee, but my best friend was. Trey Gowdy is my best friend from South Carolina, and he was on the Immigration Subcommittee on the Judiciary Committee. And I had a little soft spot in my heart for the home country anyway, so I talked to Anne, and it turns out that what y'all were asking for was not at all unreasonable. So she and I ended up working for the last 5 or 6 years on immigration. Didn't make much progress. Make any progress with the last administration. But I'm cautiously optimistic about what the next couple of years will hold. We've not formulated any official immigration policy, so please don't take this to be an official statement of policy by any stretch of the imagination. But I do know that we have started to talk privately within the West Wing, at least, about adding a merit component to our immigration system. Why we don't have one is a long and tortured history of this country. But if we were to even introduce a small component into that, I cannot help but think that Ireland would be a tremendous beneficiary of that. The number of legal immigrants that we accept from Ireland every single year would embarrass people. I think last year the allotment outside of the special programs was less than 100. It's a disturbingly low number. And I do hope to be able to make progress on that. And I'm hopeful that we can get the president over to Ireland and sort of get that on his agenda. But I didn't want to talk about that because I don't deal with immigration anymore. I deal with financial matters. And for that reason, about a couple days after I was sworn in, I had a visit from Pascal Donahue. Donahue? And Pascal apparently is my counterpart. I don't remember his title, but he does for the Irish government essentially the same thing as I do for the American government. And we came in, and he came in the office for about an hour. And then a young woman from RTE came in, Katrina Perry, I think was her name. And she asked how the meeting went. We talked a little bit about my Irish roots and so forth, and my daughter went to school. By the way, my daughter went to Alexandra College for a year, for a semester. She got accepted into Trinity, so if anybody could help me convince her to go, that would be great. With the dollar being what it is now against the euro, it saves me a lot of money. So I'm trying desperately to convince her to take that slot. And Katrina asked me a question towards the end of the interview. And it was a strange question, and I think I gave her an answer she didn't expect, and that's what I want to talk about tonight for just a few minutes. She said, do you expect that the Trump administration is going to work hard to try and get American companies to leave Ireland and come back to the United States? And I was just sitting there and said, wow, I haven't even thought about that. And I just looked at her and said, Katrina, I haven't thought about that, but I would assume the answer is yes. I mean, that's what we're going to do. And she looked at me. She had that sort of a sinking look, like, "Oh my goodness!" And I'm like, "No. That's not something to run away from at all. In fact, I think both of the two speakers who came up, all three of the gentlemen who came up already, talked about opportunities and challenges and opportunities, and economic opportunities, economic challenges. And that's what I think you're going to see out of this administration. Keep in mind that when the president ran on what some people perceived as an anti-trade platform, I think he was dramatically misinterpreted. The president is not angered by competition. The president is not angered by free trade. He does not believe that that harms America. In fact, quite to the contrary. He's angered by people who don't play by the rules and people who he believes have taken advantage of the United States of America. He tells the story, in fact, he just gave the speech to the joint session of Congress, sort of his pseudo State of the Union. We don't do a State of the Union during the first year of a president's term. And he told the story about Harley Davidson. And there's a company, everybody's familiar with the company, and they cannot sell into many, many developed nations and many developing nations because the tariff on their product is as high as 100%. And we do nothing about that. That's what upsets him. When folks take advantage of the situation in order to benefit their domestic companies and hurt ours. That is not what Ireland has done. In fact, if anything, Ireland has learned the lesson that I think we taught the world during the 1980s and have been beating us at our own game. Under Ronald Reagan, we tried to introduce a tax policy that was pro-business, a regulatory climate that was pro-business, just a general governmental attitude towards pro-business. I spoke to a group of CEOs this morning, the largest CEOs in the country, and one of the CEOs of one of the largest financial services company walked up to me and told me why he was now a Republican instead of a Democrat. And I said, why is that? And he said, because my party, referring to the Democrats, have not said the word capitalism in a positive sense in the last 8 years. And that has changed now with this president. And so what I think you should expect to see is us learning from you, us relearning the lesson that we taught the world, which is that if you want to compete, what do? You try and create an environment where taxes are favorable to business, where regulatory climate is favorable to business, and where just the general attitude of the folks who are overseeing and regulating is much more positive than it has been under various administrations in the last 30 years in the United States of America. I think everybody benefits from that. You've heard the president talk. It doesn't really apply to the Irish situation because when the president talks about bilateral trades, most people think it's country to country. Obviously, we can't do that with Ireland. We'll end up doing that directly with the EU. But the president very much wants to enter into new trade agreements that simply level the playing field. We welcome that competition. I know that you do, and there are things that you do better than we do. And that is in Western society, that's supposed to found the basis for free trade. You can go back and do what it was at England making linen and Portugal selling wine. And that is the basis for enriching both the nations that engage in trade. We also look forward to increasing the opportunities for direct foreign investment. I know that my president believes in direct foreign investment in Ireland because he's done it. He bought my second favorite golf course in Ireland, as a matter of fact. So for a great price. But he's very proud of that, by the way, the price he paid. And I remember talking to some of the members. I'm a member at Lahinch, and I was talking to some of my friends who were members at Doombeg, and I said, what do you think, before he was a president, I said, what do you think about Donald Trump buying the golf course? And they just took a very pragmatic approach to it. And they said, we're very excited about it because he runs really, really good golf courses. And he's right. But that's direct foreign investment that you all have encouraged, and you'll be seeing us do the same thing. The hope is this. In fact, I'm confident of this, that what you're going to see is friendly and fair competition, not between adversaries, but between close friends. And everyone benefits from that. And there, 5 years from now, there will be more things in my house than just Guinness and Kerrygold butter. And there's a lot of both of those, by the way. By the way, I need to speak to, I met the Pope last year for the very first time. And I was talking with a friend of mine. I have a couple friends in the Irish Senate. And they said, what did you talk to the Pope about? And I talked to the Pope about persecution of Christians overseas. And he says, oh, that's not the right topic. That's not the right topic. I said, what's the right topic? He goes, why is St. Paddy's Day in the middle of Lent? Was the question that I was supposed to ask the Pope. But I think that's what you're going to see is the friendly competition between friends, friendly nations. And I think everybody will benefit from that. You folks have benefited from it. We can benefit from it. And to the extent I can help this organization do that, please let me know. To the extent you have ideas that you want to share with the administration, please let me know. Because we want to compete, we want to compete fairly, and we want to reward our friends with fair terms. Ireland does not fall into the same category as other nations, and everybody knows it. We want to have stronger relationships with Ireland, as evidenced by the fact that I'm here tonight when I probably should be home briefing for being just absolutely murdered on television tomorrow morning. So with that, I will thank everybody for having me. Thank you for allowing me to get out of Washington, D.C. I've been there 27 days in a row. They have not seen my family yet. They're coming for St. Paddy's Day, which will be nice. But this is a wonderful change of pace, and I very much enjoy the company, very much enjoy the invitation, and hope to be invited back again. Thank you all very much.
It's now my great pleasure to introduce one of our sponsors and partners this evening is John Riley. And John Riley is a senior partner with Squire Patton Boggs. And I have known John Riley for nearly 40 years, and I'm absolutely delighted he's partnered with us and that I can ask him to come up here and say a few words. Thank you, John.
Neither Brian nor I are old enough to be known one another for 40 years. Brian, thank you. Thank you very much. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm really here today. I have a great honor of introducing the next speaker, who's an outstanding guy. But before I get to that, I want to tell you that my partners and I are very pleased and honored to be part of this occasion tonight and tomorrow. I think it was a stroke of brilliance to come up with the concept. The timing couldn't be better. I think the discussions are obviously very important. If we're not making news, we're the next best thing to it. And I'm not talking about fake news. It is my honor to introduce Danny McCoy. And I want to start by saying that Mr. McCoy is in an industry that a Scotsman once called the dismal science. I know that only because David O'Sullivan told me they call it the dismal science, and I assumed it he meant the legal business. But it's not the legal business. He's an economist. And he's not dismal. In fact, he's brought such great energy to this project. Success has many parents. Failure is an orphan. But he is clearly one of the parents of this idea. And he brought the energy, the vision to it. He's worked tirelessly with the council as a member of the board of the council, together with Brian. We are very grateful for his collaboration and his support. And his dynamic energy. He was named, Danny was named the Chief Executive Officer in 2009 of IBEC. And that's one of the most vibrant and dynamic entities operating in Ireland today. Prior to that, Danny served as a senior economist at the Economic and Social Research Institute and at the Central Bank of Ireland. So my partners, the council, we thank you being here, and we ask you to give a very warm New York welcome to Danny McCoy.
Thank you very much, John, for your kind words. Ladies and gentlemen, it's really a great honor on behalf of IBEC and my colleagues in IBEC to be here tonight. I was very fortunate in my company. Dennis and Kathy Swan proved to be a wonderful company at dinner. And Dennis, as he said earlier, is very, very keen on knowing where the birthplace of U.S. presidents are. Well, one of the features of the storm was that we were due to go to D.C. but had to stay in New York, and we had to move from the wonderful Fitzpatrick's. We're back there again tonight, but the one night we had to move out, we were on 50 in Lexington and went into the DoubleTree Hotel. And on the sign, discovered that the aforementioned De Valera was born in that site when it was a children's hospital. And of course, that birthplace was even more important because by being born there, he didn't get executed in 1916. So there's a story for your... So if you want to go to the DoubleTree Hilton, the birthplace of... So it's nice to get commerce and history together, a fine hotel. The other aspect, I suppose, in thinking about tonight, I have a cousin who I spent some time with in Boston, and he left our hometown in the early 1960s when Irish people could become legal citizens of the United States. That has been closed off since 1965, and again, that's a, I suppose, an issue that our wonderful speaker, Mick, said earlier, that one of the real key aspects is the talent flow between these two great countries. And he was 16, but subsequently was able to leverage the educational system here and ended up as an alumni of the Wharton Business School. But at 16, he was on a building site, and he was pretty green. And he was asked, where was he from? And he said, Tuam. And the guy said, what state's that in? He said, it's an awful state. That's where we left it. And in that context, I suppose, Ireland was in an awful state in the 1960s. But by globalization and modernity, and particularly through the educational system of free education at second level in the 1960s and joined the European Union, many reasons can be given for the success of the Irish business model. But by far the biggest is the timing of the opening up of Ireland to US foreign direct investment. And I think the US, Ireland-US Council was right at the birth of that tradition. And I think that what we've seen tonight is a combination of that. I just want to say a few brief remarks before tomorrow, and it's about where Ireland and the business community finds itself today. I'm 25 years as a dismal scientist, as I was introduced. I've never been more confident about the state of the Irish economy. We have, in the last generations, clearly moved to be a modern, dynamic state, but actually a little observed fact, in the last 5 years, Ireland has benefited enormously from the work of the OECD and the G20 corporate taxation, where it's now absolutely crucial that you show substance where you've got your tax strategy. And many of those who would be skeptical of the Irish business model would have said, well, this is the end of the Irish story because Ireland will not be capable of showing substance in a globalized context. But they fail to appreciate that long history and tradition that we've been talking about, that what we're seeing is substance building on substance, not just US investment into Ireland, but increasingly Irish multinational companies here in the United States and elsewhere. And the IBIC board, many of whom had hoped to be here tonight, would give testament to that, and again, I think tomorrow in the speakers that we have. And the eponymous Smurfit Kappa Group would Global CEO Tony Smurfit here tonight, I think is one of those clear substance of an industry that drives on an Irish company, a world leader in packaging. But there are many other examples of that, and we'll talk about them tomorrow. But I think for us, the theme is about substance. And I suppose in coming to the Metropolitan Club tonight, we get that sense of that great substance that's in the city, the substance of the people here. And I think that's the thing that will bind us as a business community together, and I certainly pick up on what Mick has said, is that these are countries that collaborate but compete. We're on the same team. We're for globalization. We're for free trade. We're for talent to be rewarded. We're for opportunities. And of course, we will compete. And he is absolutely right. It is through that competition for place that will make both of us stand out in that international league tables. So thank you for taking the time tonight. We're really looking forward to tomorrow. Thank Brian and Roddy and all of the council on the Ireland-US Council, and looking forward to seeing everybody tomorrow. Thank you.
This does not mean that everybody has to run out the door. I want to thank you, Danny. Thank you so much for being here and for partnering with the Ireland-US Council. This is a serious organization, and we're having a serious meeting. But that doesn't mean we have to take ourselves seriously. So I've been asked to repeat a story that I told a few months ago. It's a story about a little boy called Johnny. And Johnny had a goldfish, and his goldfish was called Goldie, as indeed most goldfish are. So Goldie spent all his days swimming around a goldfish ball, until one day little Johnny came down, and there was Goldie floating on top of the goldfish ball. So little Johnny runs into the living room. His father was sitting there reading the paper, and he says, "Daddy, Daddy, Daddy, Goldie is dead." He said, "Why do you think he's dead?" "Well, he's floating on top of the goldfish ball." So the father, recognizing that this was one of the most serious things that's going to happen to his little boy, put him on his knee and he said, "These things happen in life, and here's what we're going to do. You and I are going to go back. We're going to pick up Goldie. We're going to wrap him up in some silver paper, and we're going to go out to the backyard, and we're going to bury him. And we're going to call 10 of your friends, and we're going to invite them to join us in McDonald's. And over Big Macs, French fries, and Coca-Colas, we are going to talk about the life and death of your friend, Goldie." So father and son walk hand in hand back into the room, the other room, and as they approached the goldfish ball, there was Goldie swimming around the goldfish ball. So little Johnny and his father looked at each other, and after a while, little Johnny said, "Let's kill him." The moral of the story, I guess, is that when you promise something that you have to deliver, and that's one of the things we try to do in the R&US Council, and thank you very much for being here, and at your leisure, when you finish your coffee, just relax, and we'll look forward to seeing you tomorrow. Thank you very much.